away. Bryant for the lead.
Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. Trevor Lane here for LakersNation.com. This is Lakers Nation Live. The Lakers fall to the Miami Heat. A chance to win it at the buzzer does not go down for Cam Reddish. Certainly not the way we wanted this to end, but the Lakers, well, they were almost out of players to finish this game. We'll break down everything that happened on this one. Welcome in. Those of you coming in live from YouTube, from Facebook, from X. Of course, podcast listeners coming in after the fact, welcome into you as well. Make sure you do give us that five-star rating and review over on Apple Podcasts. All right, joining me tonight, we've got Mark Gunnels from LakersNation.com. Mark, how you doing?
Could be better, obviously.
Could be better.
Yeah.
The end result, certainly not what we wanted in this game. Not what we wanted to see. We wanted to see a Lakers win. And you can't help but feel like you saw the Lakers waste a Herculean effort by LeBron James.
Yeah, like you mentioned at the top, I mean, you almost ran out of players there. You got AD banged up in this game, only played 25 minutes. Didn't get anything from him in the second half, obviously. You know, you had to throw Max Christie out there for 15 minutes. It looked a little shaky. We saw Cam Reddish miss, obviously, the potential game-winning shot at the end. I thought Austin Reeves played well, though. That was a good welcome sign. I think that was his best game so far this year. You get 23 points out of him on efficient shooting. He was 9 of 14 from the field, 3 of 8 from 3. Got you 10 rebounds and 9 assists. I mean, he almost had a triple-double, Trevor. So that's a welcome sign if you want a silver lining here. But, you know, it's just very frustrating when you get within a point and then your last four possessions were all three-point attempts when – you only shot 8 of 26 from 3 tonight, and you were only down by 1. Yeah. And I tweeted this out while I posted it on X. I'm still getting used to saying that. Stop settling for threes. Yeah, you were getting good looks, but you only needed a bucket. You only needed a bucket. And the last four shots were all three-pointers when you're down by 1. I just didn't understand that.
And they were all open looks. And so you've got to take those shots. But yeah, you needed to get something going to the rim. Again, the Lakers kind of fell in the trap of shooting that open three. By the way, welcome. We've got some new members coming in. JWick13, checking out the Lakers Nation YouTube membership program, which I'm biased, but I think we offer some pretty cool perks. In fact, dropped a members-only video earlier today, preparing everybody for the week ahead. So make sure you guys check that out. But this was unquestionably one that got away from the Lakers, and it could have been an opportunity to go in and get a win against a Miami Heat team that was pretty hungry for a W themselves. LeBron was phenomenal in this game, and the Lakers ultimately just don't quite get it done. And like we said, there's plenty to look at here. There's plenty to look at when we think about how many guys are out hurt for the Lakers right now, how thin their rotation is. The bottom line is you had a 30-point game from LeBron. He looked very spry. He was dunking all over the place, 13 of 23 shooting, and you still can't quite get the win that you need. I suppose before we go any further, we should talk about the health of Anthony Davis. AD exits just before the half due to what was called a groin spasm. I saw it characterized as a hip spasm, depending on who you were listening to. And he exits just before halftime, tries to give it a go in the third quarter. And frankly, I think it actually hurt the Lakers because Anthony Davis couldn't move much out there. And so the Lakers gave up some runs with AD unable to do much. And then he exits the game eventually for good. So all eyes on the health of Anthony Davis. Now, is he capable of playing? Can he come back? LeBron had to spend 37 minutes on the floor in this one, trying to come back and get the win. This is not what this Lakers season was supposed to look like. This was supposed to be the team with all the depth to withstand injuries to LeBron and AD, with all the depth to have these guys not play as many minutes. And down the stretch, they had 6 players left. And part of that was a player getting kicked out of the game. We'll talk about D'Angelo Russell. But I don't know if I've ever seen anything quite to this degree. Mark, we've seen teams get hit by injury before. There's the infamous picture of Chris Kaman laying on the Lakers bench because they were so shorthanded. But six, now seven games into the season, to be missing almost your entire wing rotation, in addition to Gabe Vincent. This is unreal what we're seeing. And now Anthony Davis dealing with an injury. Who knows if he'll be able to go for this next game. Like I said, the Lakers were down to six true rotation players to close out this game. This is brutal on the injury front.
Yeah, it's tough, man. And I saw a comment asking, why was Cam Reddish on that last play? Well, who else were you going to put in?
It was him or Max Christie. It was the 20-year-old. Yeah. Those were the options. And part of that, maybe you could say, well, D'Angelo Russell shouldn't have been kicked out because that could have been D'Angelo Russell in that corner. But yeah, look, you can argue it should have been Austin Reeves maybe in the corner or whatever. But Darvin, I'm sure, had reasons for why guys were where they were. But yeah, in that moment, the choice was to finish the game on an offensive possession, and neither one of these is necessarily a great option. It was either Max Christie or Cam Reddish. And you can argue it should be Max Christie because he's the better three-point shooter, but Darvin went with Cam Reddish. That was it. There's no D'Lo. He got kicked out. There's no Rui. There's no Jared Vanderbilt, who you're probably not going to have over there anyway, but you're not going to have Gabe Vincent. Jackson Hayes is missing. Torian Prince just came back from injury. This is absolutely unreal.
Yeah, I mean, in that situation, you can't be mad at him for leaning with the more experienced guy in Cam Reddish over Max Christie in that moment. So, you're not working with much there. So, yeah, I'm not mad at that decision. Well, I will say, though, I didn't like the play design of that last play. The whole LeBron, the top of the key, because the thing with that is then you have 10 sets of eyes on him. Right. It's easier for the defense to zone in on him. And you know he's going to most likely drive to the rim in that situation, only down one. So then they were able to obviously collapse him. And, we always do this with LeBron, but it's the truth. He did technically make the right basketball play. He had three guys converging over to him. He kicked it to a wide open guy in the corner, which is the easiest three in the league, right? The short corner three. And he just missed it. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, I know people maybe want LeBron to force the action there and shoot over two or three guys, but it's just not how he plays. And we've been watching him for 21 years. So he made the right basketball play and it just didn't fall.
Yeah, you just got to knock down those shots. And they made the right basketball play four times in a row and all four threes just missed. The Lakers finished just 31% from three. Again, if that stat instead of 8 for 26 reads 9 for 26, the Lakers are walking away with the win. That's how close it was. I've got somebody saying, why settle for a three if only down one? I don't think they settled for the three. That was the open look, was the three. It's not like they forced a three or anything like that. The Heat completely collapsed into the paint and left Cam Reddish all alone and dared him to knock down the open look, and he just missed the shot. That was unfortunate the way that all went. Drew said, no defense needed. Why was Reddish in the game? Again, the option was Reddish or Max Christie. And again, if I'm just looking at three-point percentage and that's it, I'm going with Max Christie. But in that moment, and look, Darvin has made plenty of mistakes and we've spent plenty of time criticizing him, but sometimes the cold percentages aren't the final decision maker. You think about who's got more experience, who's in more of a rhythm in that game. All those sorts of things matter when a coach is making a decision about who to put in at crunch time. And also you have to factor in the play wasn't necessarily drawn up specifically to get Cam Reddish a three like that. That wasn't the goal, was to get Cam Reddish an open three. That's what became available once LeBron drove. I would assume that if you're Darvin Ham, not again intending to draw up a play for Cam Reddish to shoot a three, you're probably thinking if LeBron drives and gets something going to the rim, Cam has a better chance of flying in and getting a tip or something like that. And he's not wrong on that one. So again, those were the options. It was Cam Reddish or Max Christie. That was all he had to choose from. Yes, you would like to see somebody other than Cam taking that shot, but I don't think the play was drawn up specifically to get a three for Cam Reddish.
Yeah, and I see the comments are going crazy right now. I think it's totally unfair to rip Darvin Ham in this situation. Now, trust me, he deserves a lot of blame for things he's done since being a Lakers head coach, but I don't think, just throwing him to the side because he chose Cam Reddish in that situation over Max Christie, who, I mean, quite frankly, hasn't shown you much. I mean, let's just be honest. I mean, He played 15 minutes tonight. He was 2 of 3 from the field, 0 of 1 from three. He was a -8 and plus minus. I mean, it's not like Max Christie was lighting the world on fire tonight. I could see if he made a couple threes in the game and was in a good flow, then okay, yeah. But when they were both kind of on even footing, I mean, I don't think there was a big gap between the performances between Cam Reddish and Max Christie. You're going to go with the more veteran guy in that situation.
Now, I think if you're going to have any kind of a complaint here, it's not that Cam Reddish was in the game. It's that it should have been someone else in the corner, given that that's probably a high likely area that's going to pop open.
That's fair.
And yeah, look, Torian Prince has been a great corner three shooter for his career. Austin Reaves had just missed some threes, but he'd be a better shooter, right? There's some other choices you could have put there. But again, perhaps the thinking was Cam has the best shot of any of them of flying in from the baseline and doing something. And it just so happened that it broke down where he needed to shoot the three. But in terms of why put Reddish in the corner, again, hindsight being 2020, yeah, I'm putting somebody else there, but this is the way it broke down. Face reality, Braun passing to Reddish for the game winner, WTF. No Braun, layup, draw a foul, pass to Prince or Reaves. Cam hasn't proved anything to earn that shot. I mean, in the moment, like if you're LeBron, you're in that moment, are you really stopping to think, gosh, that's the guy that's wide open is Cam and I can't give it to him, so let me try to force a pass back out behind me to Prince or Reaves? I don't know. Again, that's where you could say it should have been someone else in the corner, but I don't know. I don't think LeBron wasn't going to get the foul call there. The Heat were just collapsing and then just putting hands up. You can argue LeBron should have taken the shot, but he has consistently shown he makes the right basketball play. In this case, he hit the open teammate. And look, if Cam knocks that shot down, we're all praising LeBron for making the right play in a tough moment.
Yeah, and here's the thing with the drawing the foul thing. You kind of alluded to it. We've seen time and time again where LeBron drives to the rim with reckless abandon, but it's controlled, right? But I'm just saying that. And he gets fouled. They never call it. We remember the infamous no call in Boston last year, right?
Yeah, right.
And this one, he didn't even have a clear path. I mean, his path got cut off immediately once he put the ball on the ground. If you go back and watch the play, I would dare you guys to go back and watch it. There was no path for him to have a good angle for a layup there. It just wasn't available. The Heat did a good job of collapsing and they live with the results. You know, it's like, well, we see Cam over here in the short corner. Well, if he beats us, hey, we tip our cap, right? But we're not going to let LeBron beat us on a game-winning layup. So that was a calculated risk that Spo and his staff took, and it came out that the percentages worked in their favor. Now, like I was saying, though, I would have preferred maybe LeBron getting the ball in the low block area. Because like I mentioned, him having the ball at the top of the key, you allow the defense that opportunity to collapse once you put the ball on the ground. Now, if he has it on that short elbow area, then I think you have more room to operate, because it's going to be hard to double him, or it'll be more risky to double him from that area when he has the ball on the block versus him coming downhill at the top of the key. So that's one adjustment I would have liked to see from him in that situation, especially when you only need a bucket. You only need it 2 points. You didn't need a three. So I would have liked to see him. And we know LeBron's really good in that elbow area too. So yeah. I would have liked to see that. But
I think there's certainly, especially in hindsight, there's certainly other options that we'd like to see the Lakers try out. And maybe in the block, getting him the ball can be a little bit tricky, but if you can get it to him there and let him go to work, not a bad idea. Mamba mentality. So the Lakers need to win a road game ASAP or it'll be a mental problem. Yeah, the Lakers are 0-4 on the road now. 0-4. Also, Ham is wrong. Cam hasn't shown us he's a good three-point shooter. Ham had some comments a little over a week ago about Cam Reddish. One of the things he can do is knock down open threes. He hasn't shown the ability to do that really at an NBA level at any point in his career, not at a positive level anyway. More confident in Max or Wood to hit that last shot. Hope AD is okay. Yeah, again, we are all waiting for word on Anthony Davis and what's going on with him. You essentially played the second half without AD. And on that hand, like, look, the Lakers going up against this Miami team at home. And by the way, I thought the officiating was atrocious. And there's a reason. Look, D'Angelo Russell, and we're going to talk about him. He made a massive mistake in getting himself thrown out. There's no question. But there's also a reason why he was so upset. And that's because the officiating was horrendous all game long. It was one thing after. And look, the Heat were upset too. The officiating was just bad, just completely missed calls throughout the night. And so that is a part of what we saw as well in all of this, is that the officiating was bad. But if you're D'Lo, you can't get kicked out. You can't get kicked out of this game. You simply can't do it. You can't do it.
Yeah. And to your point, though, it would be different if D'Lo has a reputation of getting kicked out or always complains to the refs.
Sure.
It's like, okay, you don't think nothing is a good call, right? Like, you just complain all game, every day. But that's not really his nature. So when a guy like that gets that mad, I tend to side with him, because, like, you don't normally act like this. So it must really be pretty egregious for you to get this upset. So, yeah, I do agree with that.
So down, you're down the stretch. Now, Miami, they shot well. They started missing some shots late and let the Lakers back in the game. I thought the Lakers, for much of the game, were doing a bad job with their closeouts, particularly behind the three-point line. But you're the Lakers. You're going down the stretch. You've got no D'Lo, no Anthony Davis, no Rui Hachimura, no Gabe Vincent, no Jared Vanderbilt, right? On and on. You're missing all these players. You're down to six, like, actual NBA rotation players that you can turn to. And you are one shot away from beating the Heat. Like, for one thing, that's really impressive from LeBron, and it tells you what LeBron did in this game. But that's also some grit and some determination from the Lakers as a team. They got some stops they needed to down the stretch. And so, given that context, it's hard to be too upset, because frankly, I wouldn't expect, if you told me Anthony Davis is out, D'Lo's out, you're going to have six players left and you're going to play most of the second half like that, I wouldn't expect the Lakers to be anywhere close to winning that game, to not even to have a shot to win it. If you told me that's the scenario and you're going to get a shot to win the game at the end, I think I would take that every single time.
Yeah, and you know, most of the fan base is not going to want to hear that.
But no.
The truth.
That's the truth. The glasses have full approach.
Yeah. Right. Shout out to the optimist. Hopefully, you know, he's out there listening right now, our boy Matt. But you're right, man. And like I said, I know this fan base doesn't want to hear moral victories or anything that sounds like a moral victory. But you're right, man. I mean, you know, this Miami team, they're starting off slow, but this is still a team that was in the NBA Finals just 6 months ago. Like, this is still a pretty darn good team. And for you to be that shorthanded and still have a chance to win at the end, considering everything that went on, I do think there are some positives you can take from that. And, you know, you still got two more road games on this trip. You're going to Houston on Wednesday, which is a very winnable game. And then you're playing Phoenix, who hasn't looked like the Phoenix team that we expected before the year, and you already beat them once. So, I mean, things aren't all the way bad, because then after that, you're coming back home, you play Portland and Memphis. So, like, this next stretch of games, you know, these are all very winnable games. Hopefully AD's not out for an extended amount of time. You know, you're 3-4. Things can be a lot worse right now. As long as you can just keep your head above water, once everybody comes back, I think you're in a good position, man. Because when are we going to see this team at full? Like,
who knows?
This is how they turn any iPhone in any condition into
a new iPhone 15. I just want to see that. Like, because we have so many guys out right now. And we've been talking about the depth, right? How deep this team is going to be. And we haven't even seen half of it really yet.
They haven't had Vanderbilt since the opening game of preseason.
Yeah, so it's frustrating. It's very frustrating.
And you know what? I mean, the glass is half empty here. For those of you who are upset and angry, you want to hear this. I said the start of the season that 10 games in, the floor should be 6-4. That should be the floor. Well, you've already burned up all those losses. You no-showed against a game that we marked on the calendar as one you should win, and that was Orlando. And now you've got to run through a few games here. And look, Phoenix, they're actually probably going to be healthy for this next game against the Lakers. They're going to have Bradley Beal, most likely. They're going to have Devin Booker. Again, we'll see. We'll see. It's not for sure, but it sounds like they're probably going to be fully healthy. So is that a win? We'll see. What's the status of Anthony Davis? That changes everything, obviously. So I think it comes down to this. Tyler says Wednesday is a must win. Yeah, you take on the Rockets.
Is there something going on with audio? Everybody's saying some audio in the background. Do you hear that?
No, but I'll get it.
Audio issue. Okay.
There we go.
I don't know if it's like some background noises.
Our show sponsors travel far and wide to hustle the best. How's that? We good? Amazing holiday gifts.
So you don't have to. Yeah. I don't hear anything. We get the deals.
You gift the. There we go.
The Santa tab was open. Okay.
Got it. For some reason, those bleed through every once in a while. All right.
Okay.
So, here's what we've got is a game against the Rockets, that is now a must win. You can't give that game away. And I don't know who they're going to have. I don't know who they're going to have available. LeBron, I think, burned himself out quite a bit in this game. Anthony Davis, is he going to be available to play? Darvin Ham said no update just yet after the game, but AD's in good spirits. Rui Hachimura, will he be back? We don't know yet. Still in concussion protocol. The Lakers, it all depends on how he's progressing in the concussion protocols. Gabe Vincent will be out. Jared Vanderbilt will be out. You've got to find a way to go into Houston and get a win like that. The games that you should win are becoming all the more critical now that you've dropped the game to Miami at the buzzer, now that you dropped the game to Orlando. You've got to win on Wednesday against Houston.
Yeah. But don't you think it's a little too early to say must wins, though? It's hard for me to get there this early in the season. It's still obviously a game you want to get, like, for sure, because you don't want to start getting behind in the standings. And, you know, these are games that we talk about that you got to take care of, because we'll look back on it, you know, February, March, and like,
yeah,
you lost to the Rockets, you lost to the Magic, you know, like, you don't want those games to keep piling up. But it's still hard for me to get there on must win this early. But I feel where you're coming from, though. I definitely feel where you're coming from, though.
You got to take advantage of it. You gave away essentially two games here against Orlando and against Miami. Again, you had an opportunity to win. There's some circumstances that are why, you know what? Again, I predicted the Lakers to beat Miami. If AD's healthy, yeah, they probably beat Miami. But they didn't. You would expect the Lakers to beat Orlando. They did not show up. So now that's a loss. I think that puts the pressure on this game against Houston, because the problem is in the West, come March, come April, the West is going to be super compact. Every win and loss is going to matter. And we're going to be looking back to right now and going, oh my God, that loss to Orlando is killing us now. Mm-hmm. These games matter so much in the West this year. So it's not all over if they lose on Wednesday, but I think the Lakers have to approach Wednesday as a, you better get it done here. You got to get it done. You got to find a way to get the W. And again, I don't know what LeBron's going to have in the tank for that game.
Well, luckily, you do have the day off tomorrow, so hopefully, you know, he doesn't do nothing at all and just rest his body, which I imagine that he will. We know he takes care of his body probably better than anybody. And I think he'll give it a go, just considering it's not a back-to-back. And, you know, I'm skeptical about AD. I'm not sure. You know, we're going to wait. I'm sure we'll get some more updates tomorrow, the next 24 hours. But if you were to ask me right now, I would probably lean towards he probably doesn't play. Probably, you know, just to be precautionary there. So I think you'll definitely need LeBron in that one, and we'll see who else is going to be available. But yeah, I mean, you definitely want to win this game to get back to 500 and, you know, and essentially kind of start fresh, if you would, right? Because then after that, you play Phoenix, and like I mentioned, you got a couple games at home that on paper you'll be favored to win. You know, you play Memphis, and I forgot the other one I said, but they're both very winnable games at home after these next two road games.
All right, so we've got a little bit of news on Anthony Davis. This is AD himself talking after the game, said his hip spazzed up, so not the groin, it's the hip. Said he felt fine coming out at halftime, but it spazzed up again, so he's dealing with hip spasms. Then the same thing again in the third quarter. So it happened to him twice again in the third quarter, but he said he feels fine and is getting ready to play on Wednesday. He's confident and optimistic he'll be ready to play on Wednesday. We will see, but we'll see how it feels in the morning. Because look, Anthony Davis, he was upset. He was not happy with this because he knows what's going to happen. He knows what's going to happen in the national media. He knows all the jokes that are going to be made at his expense. He doesn't want to miss games. He wants to be out there play. But Let's see how he feels tomorrow. He's confident that he's going to go, but we'll see how things look tomorrow, how things look on Wednesday, and then go from there. I think you're right. I think that we have to be at least skeptical that he's going to play on Wednesday, but that is good news that AD himself is saying, no, I'm going to play, but we'll see what the doctors say.
Yeah, and this may be a situation where the Lakers have to protect him from himself. Because like you mentioned, he does hear the media, and I think he wants to prove a point that he can be healthy and available. Because, I mean, even before the year, you talk about playing all 82 games, right? Yeah. You know, I don't think that's going to happen. But, you know, I just don't want him to feel that pressure and try to force something and then make it worse. That's something I would be afraid of. So the Lakers may have to protect him from himself. But like you said, we'll see how he feels and wakes up in the morning. And then maybe he's not as bad as, you know, I think. And he'll be fine to go Wednesday and he'll score 30 points, you know, hopefully. Right. So we'll see.
All right. Mission 86 said too many threes at the end. This isn't trebuchet ball. Get to the rim. That's why you're tall. Okay. Theoretically should be at Houston next. Yeah, hopefully they do get a win against Houston. But yes, look, a lot of threes. They were all wide open threes, but just could not knock any of them down. That certainly was frustrating. I Ambiguous said, master locks for tonight. Number one, Hamnesia. Darvin Ham had a little bit of Hamnesia. Perhaps should have gone with Max Christie in there to space the floor. Again, think you can make an argument either way. But Cam Reddish, master lock, forgetting how to score at all in the last 2 minutes. But mostly Hamnesia. Yeah, the Lakers just could not get the ball in the basket when they needed to. Had multiple chances to go up down the stretch and could not get it done. That was frustrating. It was a frustrating finish to a game where it got your hopes up again. We thought, oh no, all is lost. Anthony Davis is out. D'Lo's ejected. They have like six guys left. This is going to be a nightmare. And then, wait, there's hope. They can win this. They've got the ball. And then no.
Yeah,
the emotional roller coaster.
It's one of those things where it's like you're down 11, heading to the fourth. You would almost rather, just from a fan perspective, so you don't get your emotions involved too much, just lose by 20, and you know, you just be like, okay, we were just shorthanded and things just went out the rails. But then you get there within one possession, you actually like, oh, we could actually win this game. Just to come up short, it just makes it hurt a lot more. But from a fan perspective, but like I said, though, I do think that is a positive, though, the fact that they did fight back, considering how shorthanded they were on the road against a team that just was in the NBA Finals 6 months ago. I think you could take something from that and hopefully build upon that on Wednesday night against Houston. But fingers crossed that AD will be available, because Houston, we know they're going to get up for the Lakers like pretty much everybody does.
Oh, every team does, and the Lakers have to certainly be ready for that. Peanut Butter Badger said, a Cam Reddish 3? Is that what they drew up in that timeout? A Cam Reddish 3. Again, I do not believe that's what they drew up.
I don't think so.
If that was, then Darvin Ham should have to walk to Houston. If that's really what they drew up. But I guarantee you, look, we may say Darvin Ham's been a bad coach and all this. Like, people may be criticizing him. And look, there's things to criticize him for. I can almost guarantee that he's not drawing up that play specifically to get a Cam Reddish 3. And if he did, that's a much bigger, that is a much bigger problem. If that is specifically what he was trying to get on that set.
Could you imagine him in the huddle just telling everybody like, hey, we're drawing this play up for Cam Reddish to shoot a corner three. LeBron, you're going to drive and kick, and he's going to be open. He's our best 3-point. No, he did not do that.
LeBron would have taken the clipboard away from him.
Yeah. It did not go down like that. It's just the flow of the play just happened to where it led to that. And like I said before, we have to give Miami some credit. I know we like to look at everything from a Laker perspective, but Eric Spoelstra is probably the best coach in the league. Like, right, you can make the argument he's 1, 2, or 3. He's up there, right? So they get paid, too, on that side. And I really think that was their plan. Like, they were looking at to see who was lined up where, who was positioned where, and I'm sure him and his staff said, we'll live. They know LeBron is the thing. Like, Spoelstra coached LeBron for 4 years. Battled against them when he was in Cleveland. Like, he knows, nobody probably knows LeBron in the league more than Spoelstra, right? So I think that plays a part in it as well. He knows what LeBron's going to do in that situation. He's seen it many of times before. So I think we'll be remiss if we didn't bring up the other side in this. Sure. I think that's important.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. That's a great point there, Mark. Yang Sam said he became a YouTube member. So welcome. And again, if you guys haven't checked out the Lakers Nation YouTube channel membership program, you can check that out using the join button. There's also a link in the description of our videos that you can go check that out and see what we're offering. I think some really cool perks with the membership program. And so far, we've had a lot of people saying they've been really enjoying it. So check that out. You can even gift memberships to each other in the chat, which I think is really cool. This kind of like sharing mentality that we've got here. But all right, Mark, we need to, you know, I've got a lot more questions to get through, but I want to get to this. You know, we like to take one thing and kind of identify that as the most annoying thing of the night. And there's a lot of options from this game. And I have a feeling the chat is ready for this little venting session here. So let's do it.
Master Lock of the Night.
The Master Lock of the Night. Chat, let us know, what did you feel was the most annoying thing from this game that you would like to put in Chris the Masterpiece Master's finishing hold, the Master Lock? Mark, what do you have as your most Master Lock worthy either person, moment? What do you have for this game?
Oh man, there's a couple places you can go here. I think for me, it's just the overarching theme of, and this is a collective thing, it's not just one person though. The lack of rotations on the outside on these 3-point shooters. I mean, the Heat really could have shot better than what they did. It kind of tailed off at the end. At one point, they were shooting over 40%. They ended up shooting only 32%. But they had a lot of open threes at the end that they missed. I mean, I think just the lack of overall communication, you keep seeing that over and over again. And you keep wondering, when is that going to get cleaned up? And I think that was the difference, especially through the first three quarters. You know, the Heat were making threes and the Lakers were not. I know it sounds pretty simple, but I mean, if you look at the numbers, you know, we watched the game, but if you look at the numbers, that's pretty much the difference, right? Everything else is pretty even for the most part. Lakers actually had more fast break points. It was 19-9. The turnovers were about equal. The Heat had 18, and Lakers had 17. So, I mean, when I look at that, the Heat made four more threes. They got up a lot more, but I think that's also because the lack of communication where they were getting open shots and they were letting it fly. And the Lakers are lucky they didn't make no more than what they did.
Yeah, I was not super pleased with the Lakers' closeouts behind the three-point line. I thought Miami got a lot of really good looks. And I'll be honest, you know, look, I'm not – LeBron had a very, very good game. Obviously, he had a throwback performance. There were a number of times, though, where you saw LeBron not close out, where you saw LeBron not box out the way he needed to. The Heat, clearly, word is out that – the Lakers are a team that you can punish on the glass because the Heat just went right after. Every single time it looked like the Lakers had a rebound where the other team would typically just run back down the floor, the Heat made a concerted effort to go pressure that. And a couple of times it turned into Heat points. So these issues that the Lakers have had, not closing out on three-point shooters, not boxing out. Again, LeBron, I thought, was not good in terms of his closeouts, not good with his box outs either. Not just him, though, it was a lot of players. They've got to be fixed, and we keep talking about it. They've got to fix these problems that they've had. So that's, you know, that's something, because now we're starting to see teams really key on that and focus on it because they recognize that these are ways that you can hurt this Lakers team. And it's simple focus. It's focus, it's effort, it's attention to detail. It's all of those things. It's not, well, the Lakers aren't a good three-point shooting team because they don't have three-point shooters or something like that. This is the Lakers aren't focused in certain areas, and so that's causing problems. All right. I think there's a lot of things that can be master locked. Injuries, certainly. As Edward says, master lock all these injuries. Yep. Master lock the injuries. Omar said master lock the offensive rebounds, the transition defense, the closeout shooting on three-point shooters. Yep. Can master lock all that stuff, but I'll tell you what I'm putting in the master lock. It's D'Angelo Russell, who after the game, he said he still doesn't know what he did to get the second technical. And look, if D'Lo really didn't do anything, because remember, it was the other official that came in, not the official he was talking to. It was a different official that came in and gave D'Lo a second tech and kicked him out of the game. If that was a mistake in some way, if something was said by another player and the ref misheard it and thought it was D'Lo, I don't know. I don't know exactly what the situation is, but D'Lo saying, I don't know what I said. I don't know what happened. That tells me maybe there's something there. Maybe.
Yeah.
On the flip side, though, if he did, and I understand why D'Lo would be frustrated with the officials, because they were bad, bad, bad. All kinds of terrible stuff from that crew. Just blatantly missed calls all night long. If D'Lo did keep talking and say something to get himself ejected, that is Master Lock worthy. That is beyond Master Lock worthy, given the context of the team. Not only is he a starter, and so you need him on the floor, so he shouldn't be, no matter what the refs are doing, he shouldn't be getting himself teed up. He shouldn't get himself at risk for getting kicked out of the game. But Anthony Davis is hurt. You've got all of these play, all your depth pieces are gone. They're all injured. And you're talking about if somebody gets ejected, you're down to six actual rotation guys plus your two-way guys, right? That's what we're looking at here, right? D'Lo is then potentially getting us into territory where, not because there's a blowout, but out of necessity, it's Damoy Hodge, it's Colin Castleton, it's Alex Fudge coming in for the Lakers. And I like all those guys for their own reasons, but
yeah,
a crunch time game against the Heat is not time to put those guys into the game. So D'Lo simply cannot, no matter how bad the refs are, he can't get himself kicked out. Now, again, I put that qualifier on there because if he really didn't say anything and the refs screwed up again, which, given how bad this crew was, wouldn't shock me. If that's what happened, then D'Lo's forgiven if he really didn't do anything. But if he did keep talking after he got that first technical and he got himself tossed, you simply can't do that. He's got to be better than that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm glad you brought up the rebounding as well, because I was going to touch on that too. Both teams actually were tied in defensive rebounds at 33, but the difference was why the Heat out-rebounded the Lakers by six, because they had six more offensive rebounds. And getting those extra possessions, it's just crucial, man, especially when you lose by 1 point. You look back at those moments and, you know, the second chance opportunity, second chance points, and there's another difference in the game there. And, you know, there's a couple times where I saw guys were ball watching. They weren't putting a body on a body. They were just looking, and, you know, the Heat got a long rebound off a three-point attempt. That happened several times tonight. And I'm sure, I mean, it's, you can obviously contribute some of that to AD not being there for most of the second half. But still, I mean, it's just basic fundamental things that I wasn't seeing as far as boxing out.
Yeah. And that's been a consistent problem. That's why, again, you're going to see teams keep doing it, keep crashing the boards against the Lakers, because word is out, obviously, that you can hurt them that way. This one says, superstar of the night should be LeBron. Yeah, I didn't feel like the just reading the room, it didn't feel like the mood was right to do superstar of the night or star in your role. But Austin Reeves is star in your role. Yeah, we should talk about Austin, who had a fantastic game, almost had a triple-double. Hopefully, you know, this doesn't get overlooked in all of this, because we've been waiting for Austin to kind of bounce back. 9 of 14 shooting, 10 boards, 9 assists, a steal, 23 points, and 3 of 8 from deep. Austin had to play 40 minutes, in part because D'Lo got ejected and also because Gabe Vincent is out. But I thought this was a really good performance from Austin, and hopefully we get a lot more of this in games to come.
Yeah, absolutely. I definitely don't want that to get overshadowed. This was clearly his best game of this young season thus far. And I think, like you mentioned, with the guys being out, he was forced in a role in which he excelled in. I think this can go a long ways to building up his confidence and looking more like the Austin Reeves that we saw last year, and even better, right? Because we were raving about him in the summer playing with the Team USA. So I do think that's a good sign in the right direction. It's just, you just want to see this team at full, man. I just can't wait till we can finally see this team full, man. I really think this team could still be special, man. When you get everybody back, it's just frustrating right now with all the missing pieces, and you never know who's going to be there day in and day out. Like, I don't think people really understand how hard that is, especially not just on the players, but the coaching staff. We don't know who's going to be available game by game. You know, you're juggling lineups and trying to figure out a rotation, and you can't do that when you have so many missing pieces day in and day out. So I know people are hard on Ham, and yes, I get it. I've critiqued Ham as well. Like, I'm not trying to act like he's not without blame, but I do think we have to acknowledge what is going on with this roster from an injury standpoint. This is substantial. Like, is there any other team that has more injuries than the Lakers right now in the league?
It's crazy.
I'll be hard pressed to find it.
The crazy thing too is that the national media hasn't caught up to this. They have, because it's not LeBron or AD that's hurt.
Yeah.
Or even Austin Reeves or D'Lo. It's not those guys. It's all of your other guys that you really need in order to have a true team, right? That's how this team is built, is to have depth. They're all out. Like, everybody's. And the crazy thing is, like, it's not even, did Jackson Hayes go down in a heap after turning his ankle in the game? No. It just, and then suddenly it's a surprise. Jackson Hayes is on the injured report. He's got a sprained ankle. It's stuff that's coming from out of nowhere. What, Gabe Vincent has a swollen knee? He's not going to be reevaluated for 2 weeks. Where did that come from? You've got Torian Prince gets scratched. He's announced in the starting lineup and then gets scratched because of knee tendonitis. Like, just
crazy
out
stuff.
Of the blue, random stuff coming up out of nowhere. And that, I think, has led to the frustration as well. It's like, what is going on where you've got so many guys going out hurt? It's just complete misfortune here so far. All right, let's see here. Good guy said, I hope this isn't a year where the Lakers suck due to injuries. 100%. They got to get healthy. These Santos said, we're not the Warriors. We were only down by one. What is the team's obsession with chucking up threes? I get it was a wide open look. And yeah, you'd prefer it to be somebody else other than Cam Reddish. But I mean, it was a wide open shot to win the game. And so they went with that, even though it wasn't three. But they had four wide open threes down the stretch, and they missed all of them. And that's how it goes sometimes, unfortunately. I don't think they were trying to generate a three. I think the Heat collapsed in the paint and said, if you're going to beat us, it's going to be on a deep shot. And that's
exactly, I will say, though, the one I didn't really like, I think it was the first or second one in the midst of the fourth, the Reeves one
where he could have swung at one more to Torian Prince.
That wouldn't even talk about that one, but that would be my second one I was most mad about. But it was the LeBron pull up one. Remember on the left wing, and he pulled up.
Oh yeah,
and it was, yeah, that felt like I'm back in Miami.
Yeah,
I'm feeling myself type three. And we know LeBron typically, he does have tendencies of doing that. I just felt like in that moment, and it was kind of like a semi transition. I feel like he could have attacked the rim there. I wasn't a big fan of that one, but yeah, the Austin Reeves one too. He could have definitely swung it got a better shot there as well. But yeah, the last two, I don't really mind. I can't remember the one. Was it the Reeves one before the Reddish one, or was another one? I feel like there was I can't remember which one it was.
There were a couple of Reeves attempts. There was a Reddish one. There was a LeBron one.
There was one Reeves where I didn't mind, but it was the one that you're talking about I didn't really like. And then obviously the last one, I mean, you just made the right play and it just didn't go in. So I can't get mad at that one. But.
Jamie is not happy with James Williams. That is the most incompetent ref in the NBA. Well, the Celtics ref isn't in the league anymore. Joseph said the NBA needs to do a top 10 on LeBron versus Heat. Blocks, dunks, he did it all. We're just thin and don't have many bodies to use. 5 versus 8 with refs giving techs like they were going out of fashion. Yeah, a lot of technical fouls. But there were a lot of technical fouls because the players were frustrated with the officials. Because they were making mistakes. They weren't doing their job. And so players were frustrated. So, of course, they're going to be frustrated and they're going to say something. And so there were a lot of texts. Again, the players maybe need to do a better job not saying stuff and understanding that, yes, referees are human, but that was also a very poorly officiated game. Reeves' best game of the season wasted, Jay says. Yeah, it was. It was also a really good LeBron performance that unfortunately was wasted. Ace of Hearts said Wood was under the basket with Richardson on him for a lob. Yes, I did see that. in that moment. LeBron, when he's driving, a little drop-off pass may have been there to Christian Wood. Richardson is pretty good when it comes to stealing the ball. So again, this is all happening game speed. So there's not, it's not like LeBron's driving in and says, I think I can give the ball to Christian Wood, or maybe I should give it to Cam. Let me ponder for a moment. No, he's got to make a decision in a fraction of a second. Richardson's pretty good at reaching his hand in to get a steal. I can understand if he'd be a little worried about trying to feed that to Christian Wood. But yes, he did have the seal on Richardson to potentially get the drop off. He probably would have gotten fouled. Richardson would have wrapped him up. And then Christian Wood probably would have been going to the free throw line. Anyway, Ace of Hearts goes on to say, like I said earlier this year, I don't care if we have 8 Steph Currys on the rosters. The Lakers will never be a 3-point shooting team, especially when you only need 2 points to win. Yeah, the Lakers, the 3 ball has not been there much this year. I do think they're a better 3-point shooting team than what we've seen so far, but it abandoned them at a bad time in this one, that's for sure.
Yeah, and to that last play again, it, like you said, it's easy when you take a screenshot or slow the play down, like, why didn't LeBron pass it to Wood right there? And I think he didn't have the best of angle there. I mean, mm-hmm. if you're watching it in full-time speed, I didn't really think like, oh, okay, yeah, you had Wood there. But like I said, once you take screenshots and slow it down and stuff like that, it's easier to critique. So yeah, in that moment, I think it's a lot harder than people realize.
It certainly is. It's a split second decision. And so that's definitely not easy. This one says, please talk about all of those unnecessary 3-point attempts when we were down by 1. Again, part of that is I think you credit the Miami defense for giving up those 3-point, for forcing the Lakers to take those threes. I mean, that was what was open. And you can say it's open for a reason and you need to take the ball to the basket. It's tough. Look, people say it's a make or miss league, and there's some truth to that. The Lakers right now are the 29th ranked team in 3-point percentage in the NBA at just 29.8%. So that's about 5 or 6% off of what typically is league average in this era, which is like 35, 36% from 3. That's not good. I still think they're a better 3-point shooting team than that, but they just haven't been able to knock them in so far. I think at a certain point you have to decide, do we take the wide open, and I mean wide open, looks and trust that at some point we're going to knock these down? Or do you break and say, you know what? I know these are open, but maybe we're open for a reason and we got to start doing something different. I do wonder where the breaking point is with that.
It's a fine line. I think it depends on the player. Like, you know, I definitely want Austin Reeves taking open threes whenever he gets them. I still, even like, especially in the short corner, I still don't mind Cam Reddish taking open threes in the corner. Like, I'm still okay with that. You have to keep the defense somewhat honest. Like, if you just get to the point where you're just not shooting them at all, like you make yourself a lot easier to guard. So, you know, you guys just have to start knocking them down. I don't think this is the 29th 3-point shooting team in the league. I mean, I know they are stats wise right now, but I do think they can find themselves to at least get in the middle of the pack. I think once the season goes on, you know, you get some guys back, you have fresher legs too. That's another thing. And we're not, I don't think we're realizing here, when you're missing so many guys, you're asking people that normally would play less to play more minutes. And the more minutes you play, the more tired your legs are, which means you're probably not going to be as good shooting from the outside. So I think that's another thing. Once you have your deep roster fully assembled, guys are playing tighter minutes and have fresher legs to knock down these open threes later in the game. So that's one thing I also want people to keep in mind.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You're putting more minutes on these guys. That's going to make it more difficult. And so to finish out the game, like, if you have a full healthy team, how many of those guys are actually on the floor in this situation? Austin, LeBron, that may be it.
Yeah, right?
I mean, Christian Wood maybe is in the game.
Yeah, that's the only maybe.
Cam Reddish, Torian Prince, maybe, depending on what the situation is exactly.
Cam, I'll probably say no.
Cam's a definite no.
Yeah, he's for sure no. And then you got maybes with Wood and Prince.
Yeah.
But the only two for sure is LeBron and AR.
Yeah. So
yeah.
There you go. Veronica said the Celtics lost, a little consolation.
Oh, they lost the game. I didn't see that.
I always enjoy when the Celtics lose. They haven't lost yet this year. So at least there's a little something. A little something. Celtics lose a game. We'll take that. We'll take that. Josh said the game was entertaining, to say the least. But man, I can't blame Reddish for that shot. If only it had been Wood or Reeves in the corner. Yeah, I think looking at this Lakers roster, of the available players, I think I would have taken everybody else before Reddish. And I'm not trying to like trash Reddish or anything. I'm just talking about in terms of 3-point skill. Right, of the six guys who are available, Austin Reeves, Christian Wood, Torian Prince, LeBron James, and Max Christie, I think I would rank in terms of who I would want most taking that corner three. I think Reddish would be last on my list.
Yeah.
Out of that group.
Yeah.
That feels bad, though. That feels bad, Mark.
It does. It does. And then also, too, another thing that we haven't mentioned yet. Maybe I would like to see them go a little quicker there. So you have opportunity to possibly get an offensive rebound and a putback. You know, I know a lot of times situations, the teams run the clock all the way down to where if you miss the shot, the game's over. And I've never really agreed with that. I think you should allow yourself to at least have a chance for an offensive rebound and a potential putback, especially when you're only down by 1 point, where a putback or something like that could win the game. So maybe go a little quicker there as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you can make an argument for that. Or at the very least, you play the foul game and then you get a shot at a three. I don't recall what the timeout situation was. Omaris is asking for any updates on AD. Just that AD said he's planning on playing on Wednesday. We'll see how he feels tomorrow, but just that he was dealing with a hip spasm. So again, that's the current update. That's what we've got for now on Anthony Davis. I'm assuming we're going to find out a little bit more perhaps tomorrow. This one says, oh no, I hate this team with boiling passion. Guys can't hit open shots. Why can't you make open shots? Please, man, damn, we're bad to boot. Don't care. We're missing guys. We're playing. We're a play-in team at best. When you're missing all but six players, yeah, they probably are a play-in team at best. I still, if this team is healthy, they're definitely not a play-in team. They could wind up there in a very difficult Western Conference, but I don't think they're a typical play-in caliber team. I think they really are just missing. I mean, this is a team built around the idea of having depth. All of that depth is gone. I mean, this is unreal.
Yeah. I love the passion, though. I really do. But yeah, man, this is not a play-in team, as you know, if they're healthy, right? You know, I don't know how long it's going to take for them to look full. So if you keep losing games while guys are out, then you'll dig yourself in a hole to where you could be a play-in team. But I don't think just off the strength, this is a play-in team when everybody's available. So, but like I said, I don't know when that's going to happen. So we'll see.
Got to get healthy. Avant Traders said five possessions to take the lead and win, and all five times they shoot a three. Shaking my head. That's definitely on Ham. Why would you draw up Cam to shoot the three? I'm not going to spend too much time on that because we've talked about it a lot, but I don't think the play was designed to get Cam a three. Rather give it to Wood or Prince. Team won't reach potential with Ham as the coach. Again, if that was the game plan, then yes, you're right. I don't think the game plan was a Cam Reddish three. But again, that's where you can argue should have been somebody else in the quarter, and I think you have a fair argument there. Ree said, Cam Reddish. Oh, man, he's so mad at Cam. Cam Reddish, you suck. Ouch. Wide open, team still relying on a 38-year LeBron to play better and stay the healthiest is sad. I mean, this is what I see. And I see this frustration from a lot of like LeBron fans, you know, shaking my head. Why is LeBron the most healthy guy on this team? I can never fault a player for getting hurt, though. Right? Like if you see a player who's just out of shape and is underperforming because they're out of shape, you could say, well, that dude needs to get in shape. Like he didn't put in the work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Blame the guy, right? If a guy's knee swells up, it's not like Gabe Vincent did something. or didn't do something that caused his knee to swell up. It's right. just it happens in sports sometimes. So I have a hard time getting on players like, oh, look at this team. Why are these guys so ridiculous? They're putting this on LeBron to stay healthy. What? There's no player that's saying, you know what? I'm going to get hurt today. That's what I feel like getting hurt right now. And LeBron's just going to cover for me, right? LeBron, you got it. All right, I'm going to go sit over there and I'm going to get my knee to swell up for a little bit. Nobody's doing that. No player wants to get hurt. They all want to be out there playing. Is it frustrating? Absolutely. 100%. It's frustrating. We can express that frustration, but I'm never going to blame a player because they got hurt. They're not, that's not because of something that they did. Now, again, if they do something stupid, hey, I went snowboarding. Shout out Vlamrod. Right. When I shouldn't have, and I got hurt. All right, different story. But they're doing what they're supposed to do. They're doing the training they're supposed to do. They're getting the treatment they're supposed to do. And something happens on the basketball court. That's not the player's fault.
Yeah. No, for sure. You know, it's just bad luck, man. I guess if I had to look at this from a glass half full perspective, though, maybe this is it. Trevor, maybe we're just getting it out the way now.
Before I like that.
Now. And then after like the first round, like until now or until like Christmas, until the end of the season, we're good. You know, we're just getting all the bad stuff out the way now so it doesn't affect us later in the year. That's the way I'm looking at it.
Right. Right. Maybe that's the case. We're using up all of our injuries early in the season. And and so we're not going to see them later on. All right. Let's get to this face reality. By the way, the Clippers also lost tonight. Another reason to celebrate something. Face reality said AD's bones are made of spaghetti, string cheese. Well, I've got good news then. It wasn't his bones. It was a muscle. It's a muscle spasm.
Yeah.
But I get it.
Yeah.
I get it. Yes. AD has suffered a number of injuries. Again, he says he's going to be okay for Wednesday. We'll see. Jerome Montgomery, why do we feel like we haven't won a game so far? The reason why is because there hasn't been, aside from the Clippers game, there hasn't been a game where you said, where you felt good after a win. There was the Clippers game, and that was it. The Orlando Magic win, they almost tied it at the buzzer. The Suns win, they were missing Booker, they were missing Beal, and the Lakers still barely won. There hasn't been that like statement, dominant, wire-to-wire win for the Lakers. We haven't seen that. And so there hasn't been that win that made people feel like, man, this team's really got something. So there's three wins on the record, but it doesn't feel like it. You don't feel as good about the team because there hasn't been that true, again, aside from the Clippers game, that feel good, man, this team really has something. This is something to be excited for the future. We haven't seen that. We've seen more of, yeesh, they just barely squeaked by against the Magic. They just barely squeaked by against the Booker and Beal-less Phoenix Suns, that's probably not a good thing. So we haven't had enough positivity and positive moments to feel like, yeah, this team has won some games.
Yeah, and I'm not sure when you're going to have the opportunity looking at the schedule here soon. I mean, unless you count Phoenix on Friday because Booker's back, maybe. That's a
for a feel-good win? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, if they beat Phoenix and Phoenix is healthy, yes, that will be a feel-good win. No question. Yeah. No question.
Yeah. And then, you know, we're hoping you're thinking you beat Houston, so you're 4-4 heading to that game with a chance to go over 500. It's a nationally televised ESPN game on Friday night in Phoenix. So, yeah, I guess that game would count for the upcoming schedule. And then next week you play Sacramento again on next Wednesday. It's an ESPN game as well. You got them in L.A. You lost to them. That was last week in Sacramento with the overtime, very winnable game as well. Yeah, so I mean, that one was very, very frustrating too. That one was actually way more frustrating than this one because at least you did have Anthony Davis for that game. You know, you weren't as shorthanded in that one.
But another thing we should note before we switch over to Sean's show, the Lakers Nation post game show here, is the Lakers, one of the problems they've had is they've been trailing after the first quarter by double digits. They did not do that in this game. It was tied 33-33 at the end of one. that was a key for the game. A lot of other keys the Lakers didn't fulfill, but at least they weren't trailing at the end of one. We'll take that.
Yeah. Right. And that's the silver lining, right? Because I posted on X2, I was like, breaking, the Lakers are not trailing after the first, but of course it had to be in a tie. They still couldn't have the lead, though. That would have just been too much
too
for the
much.
Lakers to do after a quarter.
We're asking for too much at that point.
Baby step.
We'll take a tie on Wednesday. We'll talk about having a lead coming out of the first quarter. All right. Well, I know this was a very, very frustrating game, Lakers Nation. I know it was not easy to get through this. I know the injuries are piling up. Anthony Davis hurt. I know all of this. The Lakers losing with a chance to win it, and you resort to a Cam Reddish three to potentially win the game. Look, there's a lot of frustration out there, but we appreciate you guys hanging in there. We get through it together. The good times, the bad times, we get through all of it as a team, as Lakers Nation. So appreciate all of you guys for joining us here tonight. If you're listening on the podcast side, certainly do appreciate that 5-star rating and review on Apple Podcasts. Everybody on YouTube, hit that like button. Hit the like button right now. Let's get this video out to as many people as we possibly can. We've got Sean Davis coming up with the Lakers Nation post game show. Mark, thank you so much for joining me on this one. This was, despite the game, this was a lot of fun.
Yeah, man. Got a chance to bounce back Wednesday against the Houston Rockets. Get back to 500, man.
Let's go. Let's do it. Let's do it. All right, everybody. That's going to do it for Lakers Nation Live. I am Trevor Lane, and I will see ya. And stay safe.
Hello, Lakers Nation. Sean Davis here for LakersNation.com, and welcome to the LakersNation.com post game show. We have a very, very frustrating game to talk about, and this is, for me personally, the most frustrating and probably the most mad I've been about a loss since, I'm going to keep the headphones on, since Boston last season in Boston. Like, this is the most mad I was about a loss in a long time. So we're going to talk about it. Appreciate all of you guys tune in, YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. Welcome in. We'll be taking your questions and comments throughout the night. And number one, there's two things I'm going to do before we get started with anything. Number one, I want to send thoughts to prayers and praying that Anthony Davis is okay, because the season, if anything serious happens, then Anthony Davis, your season's cooked. And I know you're shorthanded, but I'm mad about the end of the game, right? I was so mad about the end of the game, right? And that's why I honestly, like, completely just forget the fact that you're shorthanded, because it doesn't matter if you're shorthanded, because you should have won the game right then and there. So again, hope that Anthony Davis is all right, but we're going to dive in here. I'm going to draw up the final play of the game, and we're going to break this down. And really, really quickly, I'm not even, like, giving Darvin props, because I'm about to criticize the heck out of him. But, and shout out to Scott Abner for becoming a YouTube member. But this is, like, not bad play design. Okay, so this is, I want to say it was 8.9 seconds left. This is Torian Prince inbounding. This is Cam Reddish in the corner. This is Christian Wood right here. We got Austin right here. And then we got Bron, right? Let's just go LBJ. All right. And I'm going to change this drawing. So all we're going to have here, we have Christian Cam Reddish kind of loop around. He's going to, like, take this massive, like, loop around Christian Wood and ultimately just go right back to the corner. Austin's going to come again, take another loop around LeBron. It's going to be a little bit wider, and he's going to ultimately kind of screen for LeBron to ultimately get open and to ultimately kind of just be able to pop out relatively freely, able to get this ball entered. Let's redraw that. Ultimately get this ball entered right here to LeBron James near the top of the key, a little bit closer to the right side of the floor. All right, everybody follow me so far? So this is actually pretty good play design, like I said, this initial part, because what you're doing is, and we're going to, you know, go over to the second screen. Cam Reddish is in the Ducker spot. And Braun's a little bit further over. Austin is not deep corner, but Austin's like enough in the corner, right? To where when LeBron James drives the basketball towards his right-hand side, where he is better towards, right? When LeBron starts to drive the ball, you're leveraging the fact that Austin Reeves is your second best player on the floor right now. Austin Reeves is having a good game, regardless of the fact that he's missed two layups, or excuse me, two threes back-to-back that could have put the game away. Regardless of all that, right? The fact that you're leveraging LeBron and Austin, having him on the same side of the floor, making it increasingly more difficult for a defense to fully commit ball side and stop the drive, it allows, hypothetically, like, you cannot help ball side because that's still a wide open three for a good shooter in Austin Reeves, regardless of what had happened, right? So LeBron drives. LeBron is driving, right? Now the defense is going to help weak side. We can't help ball side. If you guys go back and watch the tape, Austin's defender is only able to like stunt for half a second before very quickly recovering back corner, right? And me and Ryan Ward on a playback stream, we are shouting, why is Cam Reddish in the game? Or not even that. We are shouting that, oh, dude, get Cam Reddish out of the game or make him a passer, because they are not going to guard Cam Reddish. Cam Reddish is going to be the dude they leave open. Okay, cool. So Cam Reddish is the defender. Everybody on this whole left side of the floor, especially like Cam, right? So Bam does his job, right? This is Bam at a we can actually type out Bam, right? Bam is doing his job. So yeah, I don't know. This is, let's add LeBron's defender in. We got Jimmy trailing, right? We got Jimmy trailing, Bam right here. I don't know who this is, right? But we got a LeBron drive. We got X2 staying home on Austin. Jimmy staying with Bron. Bam has to commit to step up. So what is the logical read for LeBron? And X3 is probably a little bit more closer. Could LeBron have gotten that pass there to Christian Wood? Probably, right? But the logical pass in the progression for LeBron James here is to throw this ball to the corner, right? So here's when I get pissed off. Why in the hell is Cam Reddish the guy in the corner? It makes zero sense to have Cam Reddish in the corner. Like, regardless of, D'Lo subbed out and you're hurt and yada yada, I don't care. You are better off on this play putting Christian Wood in the corner, putting Taurean Prince in the corner, who, hold on, let me pull up his data this season. Hold on one sec. Taurean Prince, who tonight, 9 points. I don't think he hit a three. Did he hit a three? Oh, yeah, he was 1-for-4 from three. So Taurean Prince this season on – that's odd. Okay, there we go. Sorry, my screen like looked weird for a second. Taurean Prince on catch-and-shoot threes this season on is actually only shooting 32%, but on threes in general this season, he's shooting 38.5% from three this season. Last season on catch-and-shoot threes for Taurean Prince. Hold on. Going to pull this up. Taurean Prince. Last season for the Minnesota Timberwolves, Taurean Prince shot 39.9% on catch-and-shoot threes. Why the hell is Cam Reddish the guy in the corner? It makes zero sense to me. And that is why I was so pissed off at this play. No sense to me. I can't tell if this is Trevor or somebody else, like just using a Lakers station name, but we're going to read it. Agree it should have been Cam in the corner, but isn't Cam's defender helping into the paint no matter where you put him? Let's put Cam in the dunker and Wood in the corner. Cam's defender is probably helping regardless, right? To this point, right? But for one, like I said, make Cam Reddish the inbounder. It's ensure, right? Look, think about it, right? Cam Reddish's man, if Cam Reddish is the inbounder, Cam Reddish's man is not guarding right here to like not allow LeBron drive. And again, this is good play design to get LeBron the ball. I have a hard time of like, it's a hard time convincing me that you couldn't have used Cam as the inbounder, right? Or you couldn't have used, again, just put anybody else in the corner right there. Because, okay, cool. You can probably make the argument that you could probably make the argument because there's a LeBron James drive that this stuff right here, Bam steps up, X3 commits a little bit more towards the rim, X2 stays home on a ball side drive. You can somewhat convince me that this kind of happens regardless. But option A, there are two options on this play. There's two options on this play. Option A is LeBron James' drive. And LeBron is going to make the right play every single time. So you are dooming option A once the Heat step up and commit Bam Adebayo at the rim. You are dooming option A because option B is a corner skip pass to an unreliable shooter. And if you're, I don't even want to say put Max in. If you want to just bash Max, I don't want to put Max in the game, even though Max is a way better catch and shoot dude than Cam Reddish, but that's neither the point. You have two better dudes on the floor to put in the game. I mean, to put in the corner right here than Cam Reddish. Makes no sense to me at all. So, I'm sorry, but this is the set of the night because it's bogus. Good play design, horrific execution, and horrific just like personnel management. I don't care if you have six players able to play. I don't care. Make Cam Reddish the inbounder. Makes absolutely no sense to me. Lakers lose 108-107. Let's take a look at the advanced analytics and stats. D'Lo gets ejected tonight. The referees were absolutely horrendous tonight. Just embarrassing performance from the officials. LeBron James probably has the worst whistle in the NBA. Flat out. Like, it doesn't make sense at all. Very, very frustrating game. D'Lo, 13 points before he does get kicked out. Anthony Davis, like I mentioned, dealing with the injury. Hopefully he's all right. We'll update you if we do get any, you know, updates tonight. Cam Reddish, 7 points. Christian Wood, 12 points. He hits a big three that I want to say cuts the lead to 4. And, yeah, he hits a big three to cuts the lead to 4. Then LeBron gets the and one. I think that's the last time the Lakers scored tonight. So, man, very, very frustrating. Let's take a look at the play type data from tonight. For the Lakers, that's just the fourth quarter. The Lakers tonight, this is actually their most efficient offensive game all season. 1.02 points per possession, their best offensive performance of the night. Post attack was great, 1.429 points per possession. Their best ball screen game all year long by a mile for the ball handlers at least. Handoff game was terrible. Spot up game was fine. They were efficient off their cuts. This is so frustrating. One good thing, one bright side tonight. Outside of the fact that LeBron was great, once again, LeBron is having a really, really good year, and he had to be a scorer tonight. But Austin Reeves is back. These past two games, Austin has been efficient. He's gone to the rim, and this is the stuff that we needed to see from Austin, right? He's now gotten his catch and shoot up to 30.4%, shooting 31.3% from three now. He is still underperforming in a lot of these categories, right? Jump shooting is still underperforming there. But one of the best parts about Austin's game right now is his ability to get to the rim. He is one of the best guard finishers in the NBA, legitimately. He's finishing 76.2% at the rim this season. Austin is great in that category. Austin's been one of the Lakers' more effective and efficient pick-and-roll ball handlers in terms of scoring possessions. He's scoring at 1.07 points per shot attempt in the half court, 58.9% true shooting percentage. Cut down on some of the turnovers because this turnover percentage is pretty high, 17.1% turnover percentage, and we're cooking, right? Like, the pick-and-roll attack is only going to get better. the more Austin gets better, the more Austin shoots the ball better. Because Austin is getting a boatload of the Lakers' pick and roll attack so far this season. He has the second highest possession, scoring possessions out of pick and roll this season. It's LeBron at 43 and it's Austin Reeves at 41. And both Reeves and Braun have been great at it for the most part. LeBron 1.17 points per shot attempt. Austin 1.07, like I mentioned. Both doing great jobs there. Now, both have insanely high turnover rates, 17.1 for Austin, like I said, and 20.9 for LeBron. Got to find a way to cut those down, but they're both playing well. 56.5% for Braun on twos and 43% rounding up on threes. Austin, 54% on twos, 33% on threes. So the better Austin plays, I think it's only going to be good for this half-court offense. And it's not it's not a coincidence. I don't know why I said significant. It's not a coincidence that Austin Reeves plays well. Lakers half-court offense has one of his better games this season. I don't think that's by coincidence, in my opinion. All right, chat. Let's get into some of your comments and questions tonight. I don't think this is a night where you can say Austin played bad, personally. LeBron is definitely not falling off. Jeez, I hope that camera stat that free space put in here is not true. Let me catch up on what we have in here. Super Chat says, this is why I've been saying from Avant Traders, this is why I've been saying this team will now reach their ceiling with him as a coach. I can't see this team being better than 500 for the season. I think that's kind of an overreaction, personally. I think the Lakers with a worse roster, The Lakers were the worst roster last season with the same coaching staff, I guess, minus Damari Carroll, was above 500 at the end of the season and made a Western Conference Finals push. I'm not saying that to, like, negate the frustrations of what this staff has done this season, but I will say that, you know, to say that this isn't a 500 team, I think it's crazy when you haven't played with your best perimeter defender yet this season. Rui Hachimura has missed the past few games with being in concussion protocol. Torian Prince just now got back. Gabe Vincent's now out for 2 weeks. Jackson Hayes just gets the most random ankle sprain ever. I don't know, man. Like, this team is fine. I'm still not necessarily worried about this team yet. I'm not, personally. Am I frustrated as hell about tonight? Yes, absolutely. But that doesn't mean that I'm saying, oh, this team sucks, or like, oh, this team is not going anywhere. Look, LeBron James, let's just keep it honest. LeBron James has been great this season, right? He's been a little bit more turnover happy than I probably would have hoped for, right? But LeBron James this season, like, his turnover percentage is at 17.5%. I would love for that to drop, right? But LeBron James, point per shot attempt this season, 1.23, which is great. He is outperforming his expected shot quality by 0.25. So he is having a great shot-making season. Like, LeBron James is back from a shot-making standpoint. 61.4% effective field goal percentage, 62.9% true shooting percentage. He's been the Lakers' best playmaker this season, kind of regardless of the turnovers, which have been frustrating at times. I think whatever aspect of this Lakers offense that the Lakers want to use him in, I think for the most part, it's going to work. Because like I said, the shot-making is back for LeBron. Like I said, the three-point shooting, for the most part, it's been kind of spotty, but in sample sizes, like, it's been there. LeBron this season, he's only at 32.5, but he's had moments where LeBron the Clippers game where LeBron's been able to hit threes when it's counted, right? So, and coming into tonight, it was 36.1%. He had a rough three-point shooting night tonight where LeBron only wound up shooting, he shot 0 for 4 from 3 tonight. Before tonight, he was at 36%, like I said, from 3. So I don't know. I think LeBron has been really, really good. Anthony Davis, before he got hurt tonight, AD had been great. And then Austin started to figure things out. D'Lo had, for the most part, a pretty solid six-game stretch. You're dealing with injuries. Torian Prince had good moments with you before he got hurt. Christian Wood was kind of starting to figure things out. Once this team really gets healthy and figures out their identity, I think we'll see the team that this Lakers team can be, which is the team that I picked to make it out of the West and win the NBA championship. So 7 games in, the Lakers are 3-4. I'm not changing my opinion on this team, not through 7 games. I just am not. You know, Daryl Morey in Houston had the 10 game sample size. I'm more like to operate with a 20 game sample size, and the Lakers are at 7. So they're at what, 35% of that 20 game sample size? Yeah, 35% of that. Like, they're fine for now. Have concerns, but I just don't think you can completely rule this team out or like have a big, like, yeah, I don't know. It's tough to identify this team. Our defense wasn't good on Robinson. No, and it makes sense why this team wasn't good on Robinson, because you don't have any good chasers except Max. Max is your best off-ball chaser. So if you're going to chase off-ball, then you're tough. I mean, Max is your best chaser. Cam's not a good chaser off-ball. Torian's a really bad chaser off-ball. Like, I mean, Bron, we don't want Bron to chase. So, like, who's chasing on the perimeter? Right. So it makes sense why, like, Tyler got some open threes. Duncan got some open threes. Like, because, like, those guys are going to eat when you don't have good chasers. Oh, man. Oh, no. We do play Dylan Brooks and the Rockets next, don't we? That's going to be fun. Next 3 games, the Rockets, the Suns, and Portland. All the rest of this week. Houston, Phoenix, Portland. Wednesday, Friday, Sunday. And then next week, you got Memphis, Sacramento on a back-to-back. Portland, Houston again. I mean, yeah. These, what's that, 8 games, 7 games? You got to go 4-3, 5-2 here. 4-3 gets you to 7-7, right? Yeah. 4-3 gets you to 7-7. You got to go 4-3, 5-2 these next 7 games. Yeah, Austin. Austin's actually probably as best as a chaser, probably. But still, if Austin's your best chaser, then that's probably not ideal. I don't even know why I said 4-3, because who are the 3 losses to? Like, you cannot lose to Portland and Houston. Those got to be wins if you're a serious team. Memphis at this point has to be a win. The only 2 games that can even be potential losses are Phoenix and Sacramento. And I don't know what's going on in Phoenix with their health. So you gotta win these games. You gotta go on a little run here. All right, let's see what else we have here in the chat. The Magic are legit. Yeah, that Magic team. Try to tell you guys, the Magic are good. I'm not even that mad at how close the first Magic game was and the loss. I was more mad at some of the surrounding stuff that had happened. Not necessarily mad at you beating Orlando by 3. Because that Magic team, like I said, they're a good ball club. Let's see. What do we have here in the chat? Bron's leaving. Oh, man. Unfortunately, me suiting up won't help the Lakers much. You'll have 4 guards on the floor at the same time. All right. Darvin Ham doesn't know basketball. 3 in a row. Trevor said we should be 6-4. Yeah. Yeah. 6-4, like I said, is what? Houston, Phoenix, Portland. Yeah, you got to go. Get to 6-4. Get another 3-game winning streak in there. Get another 3-game win streak. Man, this is just such a winnable game, man. Such a winnable game. Comment says, thoughts on Max not living up to the hype? I have to go watch the film and watch how Max played tonight. I wasn't really paying attention to Max tonight. But I think Max hasn't hit the three ball at a great rate so far this season, which is kind of hurting him a little bit, and it's why he's not seeing the floor as much. But I think he's at least, at the very least, just more of a threat out there than Cam Reddish is. So offensively, at the very least. Yeah, Max isn't that consistent. How many losses can you legitimately put on him this season? 1, 2, 3, yikes. Well, let's see. I don't put the Orlando loss on Darvin. I just don't. That is a effort thing. You come out and get blasted by 20. Darvin could have coached the game of his life. You're not beating Orlando that night. Let's just be honest, right? Phoenix, I mean, Denver opening night. If you wanted to, you could. Because the whole minute restriction with Bron thing was such BS. And I think we all knew it was. And then you, yeah, I mean, obviously it was. And then you play, yeah. We're going to come back to that Denver game. Sacramento, that Sacramento game is honestly kind of a blur. The Sacramento game is a blur. Chat, somebody remind me of the Sacramento game. I don't even remember the Sacramento game. So you're at 3-4. We can give Darvin Denver. All in all, I probably don't blame Darvin tonight. I think you can blame the AD injury, D'Lo getting ejected, other stuff like that, right? But be mad at Darvin about the last play. And if you want to give, if you want to blame Darvin for that, sure. But I don't know. Oh yeah, that's why people were mad at Darvin after Sacramento. Because I remember, yeah, that sounds right now. We were all sitting there. Christian Wood helps them go on that run in the fourth that they needed, if I recall correctly. Chat, that's right, right? Christian Wood goes crazy in the fourth to help give them like a big run to get back in the league. And then Darvin takes them out. Is that right? That sounds vaguely familiar now. Chat says yes. Yeah. Okay, so you can... at most three, at most, you can do tonight, Sacramento, and Phoenix. The least you could do is one. At the very least, it's one. I probably lean like two, pick two of the three. And I would probably lean, I would probably leave Sacramento and Denver, personally. How many times are you going to give Darvin a pass? Here's a question that I do have. I don't think I've ever really said Darvin's a good coach. I think for the most part, my sentiment's been that he's a mid coach. But when the notion is that he's a god-awful worst coach of all time, then yes, I'm going to have pushback to that. Because there are things that this coaching staff does well. I think like that is a fact. This staff does things good. They do. They're just a mid-coaching staff, right? I think that the rotations are very frustrating at times. The timeout management are very frustrating at times. The play calling or the consistency with the play calling can be very, very frustrating at times. But the offense as a whole in terms of the sets that they have and the sets that they've designed are awesome for the most part. Like they are really, really good sets, right? I think Darvin does a really, really good job at getting the most out of the guys defensively. He made Lonnie Walker and Russell Westbrook not god-awful defenders last season. That, in and of itself, is a positive. I thought he coached his ass off in the first round against Memphis, where if I asked you guys who, where would you rank Taylor Jenkins in the NBA? A lot of you guys would probably say top 15, top 12, right? Okay, he obliterated Taylor Jenkins in the first round against Memphis. That is a fact. It was not close, regardless of how the series went. The Lakers could have went, that series could have went to game 7, right? The Lakers could have went to game 7. Against Memphis, and I still would have said Darvin Ham coached laps around Taylor Jenkins in the first round. In the second round against the Golden State Warriors is Steve Kerr. If I asked you all, where would you rank Steve Kerr in the NBA? If you're super, super high on Steve Kerr, you would say top three. If you're super, super low on Steve Kerr, you would say top 12. And at the very least, he was on equal playing field with Steve Kerr in the second round. Equal playing field. He had a bad half in game two against Golden State and a bad game five. The rest of that series, Darvin Ham was money against Golden State. Was he frustrating against Denver? Yes. Yes. Right? But he coached laps around a top 15, in air quotes, coach in the NBA in Taylor Jenkins. And at the very least, he was on neutral playing field with Steve Kerr in the second round. Come on now. Like, he was a part of his coaching staff. He wasn't on Taylor Jenkins' coaching staff. He coached with Taylor Jenkins, but that doesn't necessarily mean that Taylor Jenkins' philosophy is going to be the exact same as when it was when they were both assistants together. So, like, there are things Darvin does and his staff does good, but there are also equally things that they do poorly and that are frustrating. Personnel usage at times, rotations, timeout management. Sometimes they're a little too slow to adjusting in-game, right? But the offense is good. The defensive schemes are fine. I loved how they've adjusted to the defensive schemes this year, and they've changed it a lot, especially when they were healthy. I think Darvin's a fine playoff game planner. I think he's fine, right? I think we saw that Darvin can adjust game to game in a playoff series. I think we saw that last year in the first two rounds, at least. Conference finals, he got me, but the first two rounds, we saw it. So that has always been my pushback about the Darvin Ham agenda. I just refuse to think that he's not the worst coach ever. And he's still not getting fired. Not yet. Not yet. All right. And the locker room, the locker room hasn't given up on him. Still, that's another good thing you can say to Darvin. All right, he's not top 10. Yeah, he's not top 10. He's not top 10 at all. No, I can name at least 18 coaches that would take over Darvin Ham. At least. Let's see what else we got here in the chat. Another super chat. Why are the basketball gods punishing us? From Peanut Butter Badger. Appreciate the super chat. Again, like, just LeBron getting whooped at the rim. Yeah, LeBron can't get any whistle. The injuries. Yeah, this Lakers team has to find a way to get healthy. And it sucks, man. Because I really want to see this team fully healthy before I can make any bold claims about this Lakers team. Because again, I still really, really do have confidence in this Lakers team ability to make a sustained playoff run. One, because we saw it last season with banged up LeBron James. And I still don't really think 100%, you know, LeBron, Anthony Davis at full health, right? But LeBron at kind of full health right now. Right? Let these guys, let Rui, let Taurean, well, Taurean's healthy now, let Rui, let Gabe, let Bando, let AD, let all those guys get healthy, Jackson Hayes. And let us see these guys play together before we get to see and make these big claims about this Lakers team. And before I lose all faith in this Lakers team. Be frustrated. Be concerned. I'm not telling you not to do that, but I still think we got to, like, preach just a little bit, just the tiniest bit of patience. That is all. All right. The Lakers' next game is against the Houston Rockets. We can kind of do a little bit of scouting and peek ahead to that Rockets game coming up on Wednesday night, 8 o'clock Eastern time. So the Rockets are 3-3. They come off a big win tonight. The Rockets in the half court. Let's look at their play types really, really fast. Their big play types: pick and roll, transition. They're looking to score. in transition, pick and roll, roll, man. Okay, so they're scoring a ton off of pick and roll, roll, man. Pick and pops, short roll opportunities, things like that. Cam Reddish revenge game. Cam Reddish hasn't played this season. Unless I'm missing something. Cam Reddish has not touched the floor. Or touched the floor in significant minutes at the very least. Cam Whitmore played 12 minutes tonight. Granted, tonight was an absolute blowout. Yeah, Cam Reddish has only played in blowouts tonight. So it's not a Cam Reddish revenge game. Anywho. So we got spot ups. So like catch and shoot opportunities. Pick and roll ball handler. Their ball screen offense. Oh my gosh. Oh wow. So the Lakers have to be on it with their ball screen defense attack come Wednesday night. The Rockets are the number two ball screen offense in terms of usage this season. They have 42.3 pick and roll possessions a game this season, which makes up 39% of their offense. They score it on a 0.984 points per possession, which is 13th in the NBA. So they got to be on their P's and Q's for their ball screen defense because the Rockets are going to run it a ton. And who's it going to? I'd imagine Fred. Yeah, Fred's been awesome in terms of pick and roll offense with him being a potential passer as well. Jalen Green's been fine. Amen Thompson's gotten a little bit of reps out of it. So let's see when the ball handler's actually looking to score because they've really struggled from this. When the ball handler's looking to score, yeah, they're really, really struggling. Force some turnovers. So essentially, it's kind of like, I think you just play, I have to go look at the film. Are they getting blitzed a ton? Like, why is this so weird? Let me see. Let's take a looky here. I think it's, oh my God, yeah, they are blitzing a ton. Okay, so this I think you play it, honestly, then. I think you just play it straight up. Player drop coverage and force Jalen Green and force. Hold on one sec. I want to fact check something. Let me fact check something before I finish. I was going to say Jalen Green this season on pull up 38.5%. But okay, maybe we're not playing a deep drop, but like a high drop. And we're forcing Jalen Green to take floaters and pull up twos. Where he shoots 28% on pull-up twos this season. And where he, And where he literally has not made a floater all year. Yeah, I'm game. Run your drop coverage against this team. Against the Rockets. It makes sense. Run your drop. You'll be able to contain Sengun a lot more. Where he's been awesome in pick and roll situations. Right? And then Fred VanVleet, I still think you just probably play your drop because I think Fred is super inefficient. He's actually having a pretty good year for pull-up shooting, 34.5%. Maybe you like switch your ball screen for Fred, but Jalen Green, who's getting a large dosage of their ball screen attack, I'm just switching it. Come on, Lakers. Whatever. All that matters is just win. Just win Wednesday night. All can be forgiven. The Lakers are fine. Very frustrating loss. But you got to take care of business Wednesday night. You got to get the win against the Houston Rockets. We'll update you all about the status for Anthony Davis as we get updates. Very, very frustrating night. Lakers Nation, I appreciate you all for tuning in. Very frustrating night in the land of the Lakers. But we got through it. We vented a little bit. We looked at the analytics. We previewed the Rockets game and previewed how to maybe try to slow them down a little bit. And we're ready. We're ready for Wednesday night. Lakers Nation, thank you all so much for tuning in. See you guys Wednesday night, 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific against the Houston Rockets on Playback, playback.tv/Lakers Nation. Till next time, everybody. Have a good night. Stay safe. Peace out.